लाइफ मैम।
Good evening. In a socially distanced world, Design United, it is an optimistic digital platform for collaborative design and connection.
Design United is an optimistic digital platform for collaborative design and connection. Design United was created in March 2020 during a period of intense lockdown and quarantine measures within the region. The aim behind Design United was to create an optimistic space for regional dialogue, connections, collaborations, and opportunities for young regional designers and design practices. A much-needed network of support and peer mentorship during these uncertain times. Talented young designers and design studios working on design innovation with an approach that is relevant to our South Asian region have been invited to be a part of the platform. We also encourage design students from the region to share their work, be involved in the dialogue, and to be an active part of Design United. Design United, most of all, believes in creating a community of designers and design knowledge that is largely contextual, with focus on contributing to the environment and our community. Design United believes greatly in a spirit of collaboration and idea exchange.
Welcome to Design United's 24th Design Conversation, a very special conversation in progress, where we have two talented young designers with new practices, Pooja Shah of Pooja Shah Architects Mumbai and architect Siriak Paramura of Kerala. In Progress features young designers with new practices with work on the drawing board and often in progress. In Progress sessions are special, as it is about the exploration of the design of one project through process. Often the product is given more importance than process, so we hope for these sessions to enable a critical exploration and thinking of a project through the design process. Our young designers were extremely fortunate to receive critical mentor feedback from two brilliant mentors and exceptional architects from the region. Architect Madhura Premathilake from Team Architrave Colombo, Sri Lanka, and Architect Medhapa, partner at Mindspace Architects, Bengaluru, India. In the mentorship session, where the two architects offered the two new studios constructive criticism for not only this project that they are presenting to us today, but also for their future projects and for ways of thinking about practice. I am Varna Shashidhar, founder principal of a regional practice, landscape practice, VSLA, based in Bengaluru. I'm supported by Clayworks Spaces in this endeavor. Clayworks creates flexible co-work spaces that focus on productivity and sustainability. They have come with a new work from home solution. I'm also supported by my Design United team in this endeavor. The aim behind Design United is to create an optimistic space for regional dialogue and connection for young designers and design practices, a much needed network of support and mentorship during these uncertain times. I am delighted to welcome our presenting designers for the day, Pooja Shah joining us from Mumbai and Siriak joining us from Kerala. Pooja Shah of Pooja Shah Architects graduated from KRVA Mumbai and started her own architecture and design practice in Mumbai in 2017. Her studio is set up as a constant dialogue between design and construction. It's in collaboration with a workshop space which facilitates innovation, which is at the root of their practice. Pooja has been invited to present at In Progress for her exceptional maturity and material explorations portrayed in her projects. Pooja will be presenting her project, House for a Master Carpenter in Alibag, Maharashtra. Welcome to the conversation, Pooja. Our second presenting designer is architect Siriac. Siriac graduated from the University School of Design, Mysore, and prior to setting up his practice, Parinama, along with his partner, Thomas Matthew, Siriac has worked at Metaspace Cochin and White Ant Studio, Oroville. Thomas and Siriac both believe that the contemporary is an exploration of the traditional with aspects of innovation. Siriac has been invited for considering vernacular as a design intent in his project. Siriac presents his residential project, The House by the Meadow, which is a private residence for a Malayalam actor located in the outskirts of Thrissur, Kerala. Welcome, Siriac, to Design Conversation. We will start the presentation with architect Pooja. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Hi, everyone. Thank you once again, Team Design United, for inviting us to present our work and show everyone how we engage with architecture. We began our practice understanding the use of material, contextually arranging it, and spatially trying it with tying it with different experiences. The way we do it is through the art of making. We are predominantly a design and build studio based in the heart of Mumbai with an offshoot workspace across the coast where the roots of our practice lie at the junction of making. Here is showing everyone our workshop. The phase two extension is overlooking a wild landscape, a tiny transparent box which makes a peaceful place to be in and work from. The lush greens we get to see only during the monsoons, where we built a translucent, transparent box, blurring the boundary between design and making. What we do here, we taking everyone through a journey of details in various projects, which make a larger impact and help resolve efficiencies. One of our first projects where we started the practice as a showroom devotee. The entire store was conceptualized on the stroke of a wall, separated it from its actual functions to its ancillary functions. The curved stroke was inspired by the works of Richard Serra, leading the user inside in a very seamless way. The entire wall was completely structured and created in our workspace and then brought to site and installed. The idea was to use it both ways, elevationally and inside the store. One perceived a lovely curved wall feature in plywood, and from the back end, it housed all the services. The choice of material here was plywood for its sheer capability of bending. One of the pieces of display which we constructed in three materials was glass, brass, and marble. Structurally, we wanted to assemble and disassemble it on nuts and bolts and yet maintain stability. Apart from aesthetics, we also learn how different materials can come together and play a part in space. A lobby project for which we built a canopy as an overhang, completely fabricated, working out details at every point of meeting, water collection. The project inside explored a very tight space which took hand-laid china mosaic that reflects light, a material commonly used on terraces, and the use of kota stone, a very simple material yet durable, which takes beautiful polish and is a very elegant material. Different details where we mold the material to understand it further better, and a lot of mock-ups which we engage in before fabricating or making into the actual piece or a furniture. Another project where we created a wrap of internal partitions in a house, which were fully constructed in Bombay and brought to site. Contextually, Ahmedabad has a lot of sharp light, and the choice to use reclaimed teak wood added the right amount of warmth. The partition also created beautiful openings with details at junctions to hold different functions. Different scales of timber sections have come together, creating a sense of geometry, wrapping up the entire living room space, separating it from its bedrooms. One of the ways of working in different materials is also to understand its availability and sizes, and then create details in that parameter. Showing here is a brass section door, which was fully fabricated. A light, again, built in parts for a project, passing wires through its bolts. We work on a lot of 1:1 drawings for smaller projects and products, which help us understand its scale and finesse. Another product, which was a dining table with bullet legs in rosewood, which was completely turned on a machine, a very rare and wild wood, which I always feel should be used tactfully. Several details, including door handles, switchboards, door knobs, come together and play a beautiful part in an entire space. Here, showing everyone the use of steel and glass, free floating on acrylic rods for a tiny project space, which was a tiny showroom space. With these sensibilities and aesthetics of making and ethics of making, understanding simpler ways of construction that are harmonious in nature in every aspect, rather than only deriving our design through pure aesthetics. One of our ongoing projects we are currently working on is a house for a master craftsman in Alibaug. The carpenter, who has devoted over 25 years of his life in working with timber. The house is situated in a very contradictory location of Alibaug, which lies between an urban and a farmland landscape. This is a space of constant transition. As everyone can see, we tried to structure the house close to the west side where all the trees were, closer, leaving a larger space open. Following a very strict linear orientation on site, we began arranging boxes with simple functions of a home to derive a movement pattern that is tight and opens up to the glory of trees on the west side. We broke away from the rectangular form by pushing the kitchen outside as an annex that was instinctively dictated by the Vastu norm. This created an interesting pocket of entry to the house, immediately tying up to its vertical spine, running across the house, opening it into different scales of gardens, one in the north and the other in the south. The site faces a torrential downpour of rains for nearly 5 months of the year. With multiple iterations, we finally adopted a lean-to roof for the house. Sloping towards the entry, creating a sense of intimacy at the entrance facade. The volumes inside are very carefully articulated to open up to the views outside. We are still in progress of exploring solid timber fin-like projections for the house, which is stitched tight in scale and pushes one out to gaze, one out to the views and to the light. We use a lot of models to explore a sense of scale, which helps us detail our projects further. Currently, we are in progress to choose the right material for the house, where we visited the quarries of Kota and natural stones to understand its thickness, availability, scales to bring all the way to Bombay and use it in its most efficient ways. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Pooja, for a wonderful presentation. I would like to invite Siriak to please share his work.
Good evening, all. It's an honor to be a part of this mentorship series and to have presented our work to renowned architects such as Naresh sir and Madhura sir. I thank DU team and the organizers for giving us this wonderful opportunity. The journey of the studio so far has been very joyous, continuously adapting and adjusting to the situations and conditions that one is confronted to. Equivalent to the name that the studio holds, Parinama, which means evolution in Sanskrit, we are constantly trying to evolve and be engaged in the idea of making architecture. I would like to present a project that the studio is currently working on. With the present scenario and the pandemic having left all of us displaced, the project remains at its inception, unfortunately. It is a private residence for a family of four, located in Thrissur, Kerala. The Valiant House. A few kilometer drive from the site, the client took me to her ancestral house and described her memories of growing up in this house and her dire need to sort of capture, or in her own words, replicate this entire space in the design that I am to offer her. Now, a traditional building was mainly developed using the principles of Tatcha Shastra, that's the science of carpentry, or Vastu Shastra. The houses were developed on social hierarchy. So to say, a single block is called an Egashala, a double block is called a Duashala, Nalukettu, which is a courtyard house, Ettukettu, and so on, it repeats with the social hierarchy in place. Predominantly, the style is because of Kerala's peculiar climate and the long history of influences of its maritime trading partners. Now, a quick sketches of understand, sort of these were just fragment of ideas, sort of sketched out of curiosity to create a flux of thoughts while I sat to design. These are the predominant features that one would find in a traditional space. That is the Padipura, the frontal entrance, detached from the rest of the house, originally meant for human traffic, which in modern day times could be the main gate or the car porch. The Poomukam, the frontal space of the house, the first space of the house, an open veranda that protrudes out forward and is accessed by climbing the steps at the front of the house, usually a space where elders spend their evenings or attend to guests or people who are not welcomed inside. The Nadumuttam, which is the central courtyard, serves as a focal point of interaction as well as hosts various household activities. Now, with all this in mind, we sat to design. The key idea was to retain the quality of the space, of quality of the experience in a traditional space. The house by the meadow. The site offered distinctive views due to the landscape that surrounds it, that lets one capture the sense of time, sense of movement, sense of belonging, all of this entangled if rightfully designed. Importantly, we didn't want to sort of replicate the design, rather reimagine in sort of a responsive force. Now, how do you make a space and perceive it in a way that is familiar, but yet unfamiliar? The design was developed over a grid with the central space left for a courtyard. Care was given in understanding what were the spaces and how it should be marked in terms of categorizing them to public and private spaces. The solution out was sort of to create a visual marker or a separation that would be elevated in terms of materiality. Here we used stone walls that would arrange, you know, separate the public and the private spaces. Our gesture for the plan. Quickly, I would like to show you how spaces kind of correlated to each other. What is interesting would be the play of exteriority versus the interiority. The presence of outside was so strong that we had to get it in. The planning was done quite open, where all the spaces could sort of correlate to each other. Veranda space in the front sort of enveloped the rest of the house from the monsoons and the harsh wind, harsh light that comes from the south. The layout generally is very simple, sort of easy to do, so everybody understands the nature of the dwelling. In terms of materiality, we wanted to highlight few walls, like I mentioned before, that sort of clearly defines the spaces. Laterite and black granite is sort of material that is very available around the site. So we are considering to use that. The house was designed promoting the meeting and the social life of the people living in it, with the central courtyard and the spillout and the dining arranged in a line so that we could enhance the distant views that the site had offered. I'll show it to you in the sketches that is following. In addition, we plan to keep the skylight that creates an illusion in front of the dining and above the dining space that sort of creates an illusion of a larger space. The first floor plan. The bedrooms are sort of tucked into the further quadrants, restricting to its own privacy. The first floor comprises of two bedrooms connected by a pathway with focused elements enhancing the quality of the space. Hard timber jali in a traditional space were replaced with terracotta jalis to give the diffusion of light without glare. A significant structural element is also the shaping of the roof, allowing light and ventilation through skylight and thus respecting the continuous roof massing visible once you move across the surrounding. The design being utilitarian, so that the spaces should sort of respect each other to the idea of dimensions, we tried or have attempted to retain the quality of what one experiences in a traditional dwelling. The quick sketches to sort of understand how interior spaces could turn out to be. The puja space sits in front of a porous terracotta wall that lets in filtered light and effective cross ventilation, promoting the divinity of the space, which is very essential. Like I mentioned earlier, while sitting in the dining room, the courtyard and the spillout are sort of arranged in line, so one could experience the distant views, you know, quite dramatically. The skylight above the dining room is allowed to take its course throughout the day, highlighting the area from the rest of the space, you know, sort of to uphold the client's dream or desire to be in the limelight forever. It also allows better natural lighting. A separate space was requested from her behalf to hold discussions, which will be highlighted by the material that dominates the rest of the language of the house, and to give a sense of privacy and to retain the curiosity, yet retaining the curiosity of someone attending. By weaving the design through the site constraints and riches, the design tries to blend into the region with all the modern amenities, keeping it as clean and simple. I would also like you to show what the office has been up to lately and what we've completed. The mighty small house, completed on a tight plot of 120 square meter, has become a warm space built within a tight spatial conception. The volume includes two stories connected by a well-crafted metal wooden staircase. Bathroom that lets you bathe under the natural light that steeps in from the skylight above. To sort of dramatize the experience, we added blue colored oxide finishes, which sort of blends in with the light above. Couple residence, a renovation project that came to us at a very later stage. We still regret having not gotten the project earlier, as it comes with the perfect combination of a client who appreciates good design and is pocketful. An ardent automobile enthusiast like my partner, he was particular in highlighting the space meant for his cars, and we were very much obliged to do so. Wind, water, and stone. This is the first project that came into the studio and remains very close to our hearts. With the granite quarry nearby, we sort of experimented with the verticality of the stone walls. We let the workers do their job to sort of create the pattern automatically. This created a beautiful texture that adapts to the surrounding. few projects that the other projects that the office has worked on. The first one is a small chair that we designed in our workshop. The second, it was a dead space over a car porch, which we sort of reimagined so that the client could take an evening coffee break with his wife. Second is the furniture again that we designed. The other last image is of a studio space that that we created for a friend to host a bedroom on top, and a courtyard which kind of hosts with all sort of greenery, which fills in, nourishing the interior climate of the space. A bar counter for a terrace. And obviously, all of this couldn't have happened if we had a good team of workers who helped us throughout the journey. You know, their toil and their hard work really reflects in our work of making, you know, our own dream of creating a small space in this whole world. Thank you.
Thank you, Siriac, for sharing your work. I would like to thank both Siriac as well as Pooja for their wonderful presentations and for sharing their projects, their design approach, design concerns and process with us. With this, we would like to now open the session to conversation with our presenting designers, moderated by two architects from the region, joining us from Oman and Trichy. I'm very happy to introduce and welcome our moderators for this conversation. Priya Essar, an architect from Bengaluru based in Oman. She graduated from the UBC School of Architecture, Bengaluru, and is also a trained Indian classical musician. Our second moderator is Abhishek Raj, who is an architecture student from the CARE College of Architecture, Trichy, interested in computational design. Welcome, Priya and Abhishek. With this, we would like to open our session for conversation. Audience, we welcome your questions for both Pooja as well as Siriac. We invite you to type your questions for our architects. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Good evening to everybody. I'm Priya. Firstly, I would like to congratulate architect Pooja and architect Siriac on their success in their career till now and for more to come. Thank you so much for presenting, for sharing your project with us. Both the house by the meadow and the house for the master carpenter. Really interesting work, I should say. It's always very nice to get to know some more knowledge from a person who is more experienced than us. It's usually like when we were in design school, that is when we used to share the process of the design. Otherwise, like, when we attend any session or architectural events now presented by other architects, it's usually the end product that we see in the presentation. So in this session in progress, it's very interesting to know that journey that led to the final design. That's the most crucial part. The initial part is the most interesting part of the design journey, I would say. And it's I'm very happy that to be a part of this, where both our architects share their work today. It opens up a wide spectrum of thoughts and discussions and questions. I'm sure all our audience are willing to ask many questions to both our architects today. But I would like to start this part of the session with a very general discussion open to both architect Pooja and architect Siriac. If there was one experience of a very interesting challenge that you have faced in your career, be it the project that you shared now or any other project for that matter, any challenge and how you overcame that challenge, how you succeeded in that, be it in terms of budget or some time constraint or the design itself or any other thing. So is there any kind of experience that you would like to share with us in terms of a challenge? We can start with architect Siriac.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, thank you. Challenges are there every day. So, but it is. I clearly remember for that the first project that came to the studio, the workers had clearly no idea on how to bring up the stone walls, and then we found it very difficult convincing the client to have sort of replicate what we had in our minds. But they were very receptive, and we had to show sort of with sketches and go to the site on a very regular basis to sort of understand what the workers could help us in and all that. But at the end, we overcame it, I think, with the models that were made in the office to sort of correctly make sure that the workers and the client understood what we kind of imagined. At the end, it turned out just the way we perceived it. So we are very glad in that way.
Architect Pooja, would you like to share any such experience with us? Please unmute your mic.
Sorry. So one of the biggest constraints everybody starts off in the beginning of their career is always budgets. But I find that's the most simplest thing to deal with. Once you are very sort of headstrong in and what you believe, if your homework done is well, I mean, for a simple thing like the project I showed earlier, the wall we had for the showroom. I mean, it was a showroom. Not everybody has great budgets for a temporary space. It's not like a home. So there are limited budgets and there are time restrictions because they're paying rent. And, you know, there is a great idea of the wall. They love it because the idea is great. Now it's time how to choose the right material. I mean, initially we were really inspired by Richard Serra. So we said it should be in metal, you know. We were cold. We were very cold about it. I think that's where, as an architect, our journey begins to keep asking questions. Whether is what we've learned or is what we see the only solution? Can there be something else? And that pushes us forward to look out for different options, maybe simpler options, maybe more complicated options. At one point we said, just to achieve the form, let's do it in fabric, you know, to hell with the budget. But you know, those were outbursts of practicing that we are really energetic and you know we are there at 6 a.m. sharp. You know, we want to do it right because we want to do it. Coping from that sensibility, I've realized that we have to give it time and space, even for the client, for somebody to breathe and soak in, and for ourselves to soak in. Whether what we're doing and what we are making is in the right direction, if not spot on. Very simply, we said, why not ply? And what is ply? It's the base of construction. And we said that it could look beautiful if just oil polished. And just a simple mock-up made the client very excited. And for them to visualize it on a very blank scale, because we don't provide a lot of 3Ds, you know, that just gives away all the fun of making. So we came up with lots of models and we came up with lots of iterations. And then once they see the kind of effort you are putting in to interrogate at constant levels, they let loose, you know, and they let you be, and they let you do what is right, because they know you are thinking. They know you're thinking in the direction of not just budget, but timeline, but aesthetics and everything combined. So little challenges like that pushes us to sort of do something different. And we always wonder, oh, this is a great detail. Her project may we'll use this detail only, you know. Every project now, this door frame detail is cracked. Let's just do it. But whenever we come to the next project, we're like, no, that's not going to work. We have to try something different. So that's the journey, that's the fun of practicing. And I feel this itself acts as a very great master's, a self-taught master program, which then brings in a lot of energy in the studio with people who are working with you, because they start thinking too. So these are the kind of challenges we face on a daily. And now I think we have surpassed budget restrictions, because one knows how to turn things around. You know, in the end, the client would want something nice looking, functional, and we are here to give them that. As a profession, we have to address that. That's very critical. We cannot be self-isolated in our own visions of poetically articulating spaces. Maybe that's yet to come. That's yet to come.
Yeah.
Thank you. Abhishek?
So firstly, I would like to thank Pooja and Architect Shreya for the amazing presentation, which is very interesting and more commendable. So I would like to ask Pooja for the residence master project, a master carpenter. Like, there are various stages on the design process which leads to the final plan. Would you like to please elaborate on the molding of the plan as it is now?
All right. I think I have to share my screen for that.
Yeah, sure.
So like you said, I mean, how did we come to a massing which is more linear, more tight, and, you know, having a linear site, what it could have been sprawling. So if you see, we began with intuitively locating the form or the footprint of the building towards the southeast corner, southwest corner. Predominantly, that's also a very vastu-oriented thing, you know, that the southwest corner of a site has to be heavier. Yeah. And these things are always in the back of your mind or in the back of a client's mind. So it sort of began with that. And we did try working around with, should we make it into blocks? Should we stack it up? If you see over here, we also completely change the orientation. That what does one explore when one approaches the house? Does one see the facade? Does one see landscape? What is it, you know? Through a series of conversations on site, along with the craftsman himself, we led to this whole idea where it also came down to certain rules or way of living in their family, where the women are not too outgoing and they're not always, you wouldn't find them lounging around in a living room, or you wouldn't find them lounging around everywhere. They have their gungat down, you know. They're like that, you know, when I've been there, and they're like that. So we had to create that sense of intimacy. So the kitchen, which was an actual function where the woman would be, we decided to push that out as a separate little block and completely build up all the bedrooms and the living room tightly in a space. If you interestingly see in this, we ended up creating a very interesting spine. And while building, you know, just to experience different scales, we tend to build a lot of passageways, and we tend to build a lot of double corridors and a lot of transition space, which in turn does build up cost of construction, you know. We find them very beautiful, skylights and things like that. But for a certain client like this, it wasn't about you know, having a beautiful volume, but the site itself spoke. It had to be opened up to itself and outside. One had to push themselves outside. So when would you push? When you're tightly squeezed, right? And that's when you push out. That's what was the point of way of working around the plan and building a linear sort of a building itself. And if you see on the top, we have two simple bedrooms. The entire staircase was pushed out because it had to be a little feature hugging the trees, you know, while you're just walking up. And if you see, there is a very interesting veranda space on the first floor, which again opens out to the trees. And over here, it overlooks the little double height space, right when you enter, very tiny double height space, but just to break that volume. And then it pushes you out to a terrace. Now the terrace was intentionally put towards the backside for us, towards the front side where one enters, where the car sort of comes in. So it is also not to have a very imposing building when you enter, but to break its form. As you can then see, we explored in multiple model making ways. And it created an interesting pocket of porch where one can put a swing and just hang around and be a part of the landscape, which we're hoping to grow with the building. So if you see, this is the place where we took a larger overhang. So the building or the house yet looks a little welcoming and timid, and one doesn't know what's happening inside, but there will be points of transition around. So this was the process of actually struggling through plans and coming up with a very efficient solution as well. One roof, simple. One terrace, simple. You know, it just started doing the math itself. And I feel that's what a site offers, that's what a personality offers. And in the end, the lesser the details seen by the naked eye, the more seamless and the more efforts gone in a space. So the approach is eventually to articulate our roof in that manner and articulate our openings in that manner.
Okay. So coming to like a detailing part, so like I'll go into the statement, like how important is like balancing aesthetic and the along with the functionality, while some architects who believe like form follows function, or some believe that could be going other hand. What is your take on this?
Well, everybody has an approach. I very keenly look up to works of people like Norman Foster and people like Peter Zumthor or John Pawson, and also contextually, a lot of Indian architects. I mean, we always look up to the West for some reason, but it just sort of helps me understand as to what our practice is interrogating, and does form have to follow function or function have to follow form is about project to project. It is not a standard stamp for our firm. It is about an experience first, because in the end, as architects, we are building for people, we are building for nature, we are building for animals, and putting up a building out there is very simple and difficult both. But the way it blends in, the way it becomes a part of the earth is a little more important than just form following function or function following form. I believe in looking at the larger picture to have a clear space in the head, then going back to the client, then coming back to the studio, looking at technicals, and then going back to the market, looking at materials. So it's a constant approach in and out, waking up at 6 a.m. in the morning thinking, okay, was that the right decision? Or keeping everybody in the office till like 12 a.m. Or is this the right decision? It's going to go for execution tomorrow. So that's the kind of things we are engaging as of now. Maybe experiencing a lot of projects going by in years to come, I may be saying different things at that point. But as of now, I'm pretty sure that I don't think form follows function or function follows plan. It's about the experience. Yeah.
So where do you think that detailing plays a major role in architecture? So for some project, like detailing may get higher in the budget, but some client would not be accept that detailing. How would we convince the client for the detailing?
So detailing does not mean higher in budgets. That's one.
Okay.
Aesthetic compositions, I believe, is higher in budgets. But detailing for its efficient ways of using a material is smartly looking at a way of construction, which is inevitable. If somebody comes to you and tells you, I want to build, he has to mentally be prepared. He is investing. So if he is investing, we have to make sure he's investing in the right thing, in the right experience, in the right tangent of understanding. And this detailing, like you saw in the wall, the way to convince the client was that from the backside, it became a complete storage space. So they did not have to put up any shelves, you know. They can stack up hangers, they can stack up all the mad mess which is behind a showroom.
Yeah.
So they found that interesting and it worked. So it's detailing in a smart way. Yes, sometimes you end up detailing because of aesthetics. But if you look at a lot of work which you see traditionally, details are at the entrance. Why do they put a threshold for which is in wood, or, you know, those are details. Then you explore those details. Those are inevitable ways of making, right? Now, how do you just take it a step forward? Do you follow the trend? Do you break the trend? That's up to you and how you blend in with the client. So details are...
Architect Priya, I'm so sorry. Architect Pooja, please continue. I finished. Okay. Architect Siriak, what's your take on the same question that Abhishek asked right now?
About the detailing part?
Yeah.
Yeah. It really happens in the office as you sit to design, you know. So it comes in as soon as we think of a project. What happens in the studio is once we get the project, we tend to hunt for, you know, sorts of inspirations that we can take cue from. So when we start drawing, and once the drawing happens, it automatically happens. The door handles, the joinery details, all of it. We know we shouldn't replicate something that immediately comes to our minds. So we kind of work again like what Pooja said. Different drawings are made and all sort of models are made just to sort of understand what it visually, and at the end it has to look good. So we sketch out a lot to make sure that it is visually appealing as well.
Architect Siriat, regarding your project, I just had this question that was in my mind. So it's an open plan, right? There are a lot of advantages, as you pointed out, like an illusion of a larger space and a lot more of light coming into the space and things like that. But then structurally, was there anything that you had to innovate to or bring in? Because it's a really wide space without any...
So all the structural details are sort of blending in with the walls that are going to come up. So, and all the beams are going to be upturned beams. So all the spaces will look clean and clear, as that will be a cleaner height. And the volumes will be also cleaner, because all of them immediately turns out like the upturned beam will sort of, you know, work out like a hand that is protruding out. So, and that's how we wanted to clean it, make it as clean as possible. And also bring in certain elements. That is the puja space, which is backed by a jali wall, and the lighting that is being provided above. So, I mean, different spaces, we didn't want to, though we kept it as clean as possible, we didn't want to sort of compromise on the spaces or how it could turn out, if I've answered your question. Yeah.
Yes. Another thought was, when there are a lot of people in one part of the house, wouldn't it be in terms of sound traveling to, that would be helpful.
Yeah, you can tell me. You can see the screen now?
No.
Hold on one second. Yeah, you can see it now, right?
Yes.
Yes. You can ask me now.
Yeah, so I'm just like wondering if would you call it I wouldn't call it a disadvantage actually, but then is it something you think about, like when there are a lot of people in one part of the house, what about the there's no like a sound barrier kind of thing from one space to another? Do you think it is something to think about, or is it really trivial?
It is. If you look at a very traditional space, which we sort of reimagined. So what happens is that the courtyard becomes, you know, the central space, and everything that is eventually happens that is around it. So what we also tried working on the same principle. We wanted to keep all the spaces that is enjoyable while the courtyard is there, so that and the client also has her parents living with her. And she is also of age with her brother, but both of them wanted separate spaces. And very particularly, I was telling it to Naresh sir yesterday when he had asked me on why did I tuck in the bedrooms on the upper floor onto the other side. So what happens was that was mainly particularly in the need of the client, where she wanted to, you know, bring in, she's a very social person. So she wanted to bring people during the evenings and all that. So was very particular in having a wider space. So they shouldn't, you know, when somebody comes into the house, there shouldn't be a disturbance to the parents that are living inside. That is one of the reasons why I kept the bedrooms tucked into the other corner of the house and above, where they can have like a, and also the site offered brilliant views. So somebody coming in should automatically enjoy all of it coming in. That's why, that is the main reason why I kept it open and all of it looking outside.
What I wanted to ask you next, it's a very general kind of question. In a real practice, when you discuss the timelines with the client and with all the other associated parties, there's a timeline for the design to be frozen as well, right? For the final design to be frozen, and we have to stick to those timelines. But I think there would be situations where after the construction has started and things like that, you get another idea in your mind saying that, yeah, this could have been done. It would have been a better solution to it. So has it ever occurred like that in your experience, or are you always satisfied with what is done?
Definitely not. There is multiple number of chances and times where I've broken walls. It really didn't, when we sit to design and when we sit to design and create models and 3D and sketches, we tend to miss out on a lot of things. And once that comes up on the site, there is a lot of difference in terms of volume and, understanding of the space. If it's really bad, we often tend, excuse ourselves and ask the client to bring in our, that has happened a lot of times.
So it generally does happen.
No, it doesn't happen often. I mean, it is a mistake from our side. If it happens often, it does not, but it has happened.
Abhishek, would you like to?
Yeah. So I'll go with for both architects. So apart from various subjects we have learned from a design school, is there any design skills that the student architecture students learn in the academic period that they can carry forward on their practice? Or a practice is always a completely new state of an partitioner?
Pooja, you can answer.
Yeah, well, one thing that always one carry forwards from finishing college and blending into practice is sketching. And that's the only way we communicate. Ideas, thoughts, designs, desires. I think that's one of the most important tools which often we get lost in or caught up with AutoCAD and a lot of other brilliant softwares to articulate spaces more and more efficiently. Sketching is something which is very powerful, and that is something which one should always carry forward. And what we study in college is literally giving us a great platform to explore multiple things initially. And at the back of my mind, still when I'm designing or when we're designing something at the studio, we still think of that project which we did in the second year where we studied the plans of Glenn Merkitt. And that tells us, okay, Glenn Merkitt is somebody we should now open our books again to look at. What college happens to give us is a great platform to explore, which while in college, we dread sometimes the jury days and those things, and we're like, oh my God, we're going to present, and oh my God, I have to go through theory of design. But today, I cherish every moment. I cherish every lecture or everything. May that be not even related to architecture. In our college, we were inculcated with a lot of several activities like workshops and things during the year. And even that, I still remember seeing a lot of art shows and art workshops happening, which is not directly related to architecture, but is definitely indirectly related. And it just helps us to keep our thoughts open. One should always carry that forward. And the idea of sketching. Sketching is something which is inevitable and is is something you cannot skip.
Yeah. So, Akrikshriya, your comments?
We have some questions, interesting ones from the audience. This one is from Niyashin Lulu Mohammed Jalil. He wants to know how the pandemic has affected architecture and what, in your own practices, in your own experience in the last 6 months. So how has it affected and how have you...
That's a good question, because the whole concept of this house that I presented is at halt because of the pandemic and because of the reasons that we cannot meet and I cannot be at the site explaining or to the client. It's just been a visual exercise that I've been sharing in images. So it is greatly, and we cannot really go to our studios and, you know, help or, you know, meet with the people inside the studio to make models and all that. It has really affected us. And we are hoping that things will be back to the normalcy and, sort of help us.
On the other hand, I've realized one thing. The pandemic has... On the other hand, the pandemic has really opened up certain thoughts that, you know, we take for granted that let's immediately send this to site and we'll go there and we'll take a look whenever we feel and when, you know, we'll see it, what happens on site. Why can't we, as architects, why can't we design in detail on drawing boards and let it go for execution and not be there? And that's how they do it in many places. And is a site meeting always required? You know, as young designers, we always want to see every little stepping stone that is coming up on site, you know. Sometimes this pandemic has made me realize that staying away from it also gives a lot of reflection and thought. Because when you're putting a thought, and then when you go to site and you immediately discard it and you're like, no, I want to go back to my old design. No. It cannot be so easy. It is not so easy. When you're thinking, you're putting in that energy and time. So we have to make value of that. I mean, there has to be, we've spent a lot of time doing designing work. Why should that have to be just immediately changed? You know? So the pandemic has helped me realize that working in the studio is very important, or working from your computer is very important, and we can take a lot of decisions. Why not? And let those things emerge and see a holistic picture on site when you're back. And so it has definitely changed a little bit of way of working, because you cannot reach places immediately. So.
Another question from the same person. How did you use lockdown period as a young practice, as a young practitioner? I think it's a similar kind of
question. Well, it was similar. Throughout the lockdown, a lot of self-contemplation had happened. Yeah. Very similarly, we spent a lot of time painting and sketching and cooking and cleaning dishes.
Your sketches are really nice. They're so detailed and they give a true picture of how it could be on site as well. Like, I really like them. Abhishek, did we have anything else to discuss with architect Siriak and architect Pooja?
Yeah, I have one thing. So how do you believe the phrase, a signature style of an architect? It's like we have to follow an unique and great architecture has to follow a unique style of architect, or it can be a combination of styles.
That is something that one is getting inspired from this, certainly. Yeah. So what I have generally tried to follow is not to get into a style, at least at this early stage of my career. It has to evolve, I feel. Because certainly you look at a person's design, you can definitely say that it is done by him. I'm more of an option where it has to sort of, change. I didn't want to replicate, at least now, because those details which gets familiar, it's easier to replicate. So yeah. We want to, sort of break our minds to get better at what we do.
Yeah, sure. So comments on Pooja, Akhil Pooja?
Style is always innate. It is there somewhere within you. Every time you design, it's always there. It just strongly comes out project after project. And if you just work in that direction, it evolves someday. And that may be a single style or a particular style which is appreciated, or maybe a combination of styles.
Yeah, sure. That's it. Yeah, can you help?
That was a lovely discussion. Really interesting to know the insights of both our architects for the session today. Thank you so much, Architect Pooja and Architect Siriak, for your time. I would like to conclude it. Varna ma'am?
I must commend and congratulate both Pooja and Siriak for your wonderful work and, of course, presentation and spending time in this process of discussion. I really wish you the very best in your future projects and practice. I would also like to thank our enthusiastic moderators, Priya and Abhishek, for moderating this session, Clayworks and DU team, and our lovely audience. Have a good evening. Sakshi from the Design United team will share the upcoming series of events. Thank you.
Thank you, Varna. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Great job in putting everything together, and a good time for us to reflect on our own work. Thank you.
Thank you, Architect Pooja and Architect Siriak, for your wonderful presentations today. Thanks to our moderators, Priya and Abhishek, for an interesting and thought-provoking conversation. We'd like to extend our gratitude to Clayworks for supporting this webinar and all of our webinars. So far, Design United has successfully completed more than 20 installments of our weekly webinars, and we have many more exciting speakers lined up, with designers across the spectrum joining us to share their thoughts. So do make sure that you are back next Saturday at the same time. Next week, we are thrilled to have on our platform artist J.C. Ratnayake from Sri Lanka as a part of our first installment of the In Collaboration series. On September 26th, we are joined by inspirational architect Brinda Somaya and her daughter, architect Nandini Sampath of Somaya Kalpa Associates, Mumbai, in the Design Practice Mentorship Series. We'd like to thank our audience for being so wonderful, and we request you to fill in a feedback form that will pop up after today's webinar to help us continue to be better design conversation. Thank you for tuning in today, and we hope that you took value from the session. Join us and stay inspired. Follow us on our social media for our upcoming conversations and updates on events. Until next time, thank you, stay safe, and take care. Hi guys, hi Priya and Abhishek. You guys did wonderful. I just want to congratulate you on a lovely moderation session. You guys are
thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much for joining us. Priya, I'm so glad we got to meet again after so many years.
Oh yeah. Hey, I just saw the picture of the screenshot that you just sent me. No, it didn't load at all, and then I just now saw it. No problem. I saw the time, so I ended it.
No problem. I think it all ended right on time.
And Abhishek, I had texted you like before, right? We'll ask alternative questions.
Yeah.
And then you just continued, and I couldn't cut Architect Pooja like that. So then I just let her speak. Like, I couldn't do anything over there. So
I thought to finish off Pooja and to continue on architecture.
No, that's why we spoke, no, that we'll alternate. Yeah, yeah, but anyway, yeah. It was fun. It was fun moderating with you, Abhishek.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. Thank you.
It was lovely having y'all. Please stay connected to us and our team, because at the end of the day, this is about community. Yeah, so sure. We'd love to stay connected and see you again soon.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, thank you.
I guess.
Yeah, bye-bye.
Good night. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.